they want to. Talk don't bother me. I want the whole wide world to know that I love you so.
And welcome to Let Them Talk. I'm Paul DeRienzo. And our guest is Kate Bornstein, who's going to be talking about her book, which has a very long title, but the first three words of the title are the key ones to understand and to know, and they are Hello, Cruel World.
That's right.
And Kate, can you tell us what's the rest of the title of this wonderful book?
Sure, the rest of the title is 101 Alternatives to Suicide for Teens, Freaks, and Other Outlaws, my favorite people.
And it was just recently released, this book.
From Seven Stories Press about 6 weeks ago, yeah.
Okay,
just
great.
Came out.
Great.
Thanks
and
for doing the show.
About.
Welcome.
Well, you know, this is my very first television interview show about this book, so
oh, great.
You've got my cherry here.
Great. What led you, well, let's start with what led you to write this book and what the book is about. The title seems pretty self-explanatory, but maybe break it down for us how you came to write this book.
Sure. I'd been writing postmodern gender theory for years and finished up with a book called My Gender Workbook. And that was about 9-10 years ago when that came out. And I didn't know what I was going to write beyond that. And I was thinking, well, I'll write this, I'll write that, I'll write this, I'll write that. And then 9/11 happened. And I said, well, of what possible value is postmodern gender theory in a world that can permit such a horrifying government as what's down in Washington these days? And so this is really my response, I think, to the Bush administration. It's how to keep the freaks alive and kicking.
Okay, great. Now, well, let's talk about yourself and your history a little bit.
Because Kate is a playwright.
Right.
Performance artist.
As well as an author.
As well as an author, that's right.
And a transsexual.
Right. There you
go.
There, I said that.
Right.
I am. That's it.
And I wanted to...
Okay, when you went through the sex change, did you start worrying about being overweight?
No, I worried about being overweight well before that. No, I'm a periodic anorectic, actually. I fight with that one.
I was reading on your website that you had an interesting piece that you wrote for the New York Times, an op-ed piece that was in the New York Times?
It was actually in the New York Times Sunday magazine, and it was in the live section. It was about at my mom's funeral. She was down on the Jersey Shore. That's where she lived. And not everybody in her town knew about my gender change, so there I was at the funeral, and people kept asking me, who are you? And I had to explain that, well, I'm Mildred's daughter. And then that was confusing because everyone knew my mother had two sons.
I see.
Well, it was a very poignant piece. I read that. It was amazing.
Well, it was like living in a Marx Brothers movie that day.
It was great because it was very funny, but it was also incredibly touching.
What is this post-gender world you're talking about? What do you mean by that when you use that term?
I don't think I've ever used it.
I thought maybe I just I got it wrong.
I'm sorry.
Right. That'd be great.
Postmodern gender.
Postmodern
gender.
Right.
Postmodern simply means that there are more than one ways to look at things. Like, for example, I could say, oh, that's our audience. Or that's a camera. Or that's where I could see myself if I look. There are lots of ways. That's a ceiling, but it's also the floor of the room upstairs. So postmodern is there's lots of ways to look at things. Someone is a man, someone is also a boy, someone is also a drag queen, for example. There's we shift genders, and so that was the concept of postmodern gender.
That gender is not as fixed as people may have thought a long time ago, or not even that long ago, or today even.
Correct.
Or that some people hope.
Right. Well, do you consider yourself now a man who became a woman, or do you consider yourself none of the above, or how do you describe yourself? What people say?
I would consider myself none of the above. I never felt like a boy. I never felt like a man. I did a fair job doing those genders, but I never felt like that. And life was pretty hard because there was no way to tell anybody that. And so I figured, okay, I'll go through this gender change and I'll be a woman. And that lasted about 6 months. And then I realized, well, I'm not really a woman either. And from that point, life got more interesting.
So what do you say to young people who find themselves in a situation where they just don't feel like they belong, they're not sure where their place in the world is for whatever reason, whether it's gender identity, whether it's because they're gay or because they just look different, they're overweight, they have red hair. I mean, for young people, it can be so many things that make them feel outside.
Well, sure. People, the school system in U.S. culture is geared to try and get us all on one track, heading down toward some American dream of your grandparents. But most people don't fit in for a lot of reasons, as you're saying. And to those people, I'd say, hang on. It's not worth taking your life over. It is worth hanging in there and doing whatever you have to do to make your life worth living. And with that kind of blanket permission, you know, there's one rule that makes that work, and that would be don't be mean. As long as you're not being mean, you can do whatever you want to stay alive, is what I figure. And that means if it's illegal, if it's immoral, if it's self-injurious, if it's completely silly, it doesn't matter, as long as you're not being mean to someone.
Well, speaking of being mean to anyone, we do have a phone number. If we are live, our number is 212-757-1541. It's right here.
Yes,
right there in front of us. And we'll take your calls and we'll give it a shot and ask Kate Bornstein any question you would like and ask us any question you would like. Tell us a little bit what's in this book. Is it advice that you give to people? What kind of advice is it?
Pretty concrete advice.
Yeah. Well, the book is in two sections. I found that there are three areas of life, if you will, that people can be made to feel life isn't worth living. That would be in the area of identity. Who am I? Who do I want to be in the world? In the area of desire. Who do I love? How do I want to love? What do I want to have? And in the area of power, can I get done what I want to get done? So identity, desire, and power. And there are three essays in the book, one on each of those. Then there's a quick start guide. If you're feeling like a little dicey about living, there's a quick start guide to go right ahead on. And then there's 101 alternatives to suicide.
And I see what you have. Let's hold it up to the... I can hold it up to the camera and people can see what a page of this book looks like. I don't know if there's enough light there, hopefully. I'll step back a little bit. And there's the cover, which you see behind us, but there's a close-up of the cover.
Yeah.
Right. And so here it is.
This is a wonderful mission to help people stay alive, because teen suicide is one of the saddest things in our culture, when someone's life has barely begun and they already feel that it isn't worth living.
Want to try a call?
Oh, sure.
Sure, teen suicide has nearly tripled in the last 30 years.
Oh. You're on.
Since the 70s.
Hello? Hey, how are you guys doing? In the last 30 years.
You're on.
Since the 70s.
This is a great show.
How are you guys doing?
I just had a couple of questions.
You're on. Since the 70s.
This is a compelling show.
How are you guys doing?
I think that he meant to do that.
Oh,
that was like the psychedelic effect.
But oh, that's pretty
good. In case it wasn't, turn down your TV.
Right before you call.
All right. I don't think there's a delay, but there might be a slight delay.
Try another call?
Let's try it again.
Here we go, another caller.
Hi. Yeah,
same person.
Playing the tape.
Hi, you're on.
Hey.
Go ahead.
Am I on?
Yes, you're on the air.
I have a question for your guest.
Okay. Sure, go ahead.
How long ago did you get your sex change?
How long ago did I what my sex change?
Did you get your sex change?
Oh golly. It's now been about 20 years.
I was wondering, does your fake pussy feel like Limburger?
Like, wait a minute. No, we can't cut people off the air. I mean, we really can't do
that. Right.
I'm sorry we didn't get to your question about what did you call it, my fake pussy? Sorry, we didn't get to that.
All right, well, I'm sorry for that cutoff. Call again. We'll be happy to take your question. I am really sorry. I moved a little too fast on that. And that is our number right here. Our guest is Kate Bornstein, and this is Let Them Talk. I'm Paul DeRienzo with Miss Joan Marie Moossy.
And we're talking about Hello, Cruel World, 101 Alternatives to Suicide for Teens, Freaks, and Other Outlaws.
And you're on. Hello? You're on television. Go ahead.
Hi, this is a great show, and I got a question for your guest. I'm just fascinated with this.
Okay.
Hello?
Go ahead, Yvonne.
Yes, I can totally relate to your guest because about 3 months ago, I had my anus removed.
Did you?
I have a thing.
And you had it put where your mouth is? Is that it?
What?
Did you put it where your mouth you should be? Is that the deal?
I'm serious. I would faint every time I would poop, and they tried a new operation. My anus was removed, and now I poop out of my penis. Hello?
We're a bit put out by that. We don't
know what to say. Don't know what your question is.
You managed to find something that even
I said you had a question and no way to answer that.
Well,
some people will do anything to stay alive, including
yeah. Do you still?
We'll try again. Wait, there's somebody else calling. Well, we'll try again. Here it is. Go ahead. You're on.
Hello?
Welcome to Let Them Talk.
Hello?
Go ahead.
Hey, Paul. Hey, Joni. Hey, Kate. It's Joey Jeffries.
Hey, Joey. How
Hi,
you doing?
Joey.
Hey, guys. Got a question for Kate there. Kate, your new book is great. Absolutely love it. Hi.
Hi.
I want to ask you, I really enjoyed your performance work in the past, and I'm just wondering if you're working on something now. I mean, I've seen you at PS-122, and I know that, you know, you've worked at the Theater Rhinoceros in San Francisco, so I'm just wondering, are you working on a piece now, and should we expect to see a piece coming out sometime soon in New York, a performance piece?
Thanks for asking. Actually, yeah. I've got a piece coming out. Its world premiere is in England, in Manchester, England, in May, and I'm just now negotiating with a possible theater here in New York for June, and possibly San Francisco for June as well. The piece is called Kate Bornstein is a Queer and Pleasant Danger. And
another great title.
Can you do an excerpt for us?
No, actually, I don't have it. It's, but it's about the subject of daddies. It's about being a daddy. It's about my daughter, who's now 33 years old. It's about being out of touch with her, not because I'm transsexual. But because my daughter is in the Church of Scientology, and so it deals with that sort of thing as well.
Why is that cause a problem? Why is the Church of Scientology connection?
The Church of Scientology is a brand new religion, and as such, well, by definition, it's in its most fundamental stage of development, and they don't have right now any place for someone who's done something weird like me. And when somebody leaves the Church of Scientology, they become apostates, seen as evil. And
so you're involved in the Church of Scientology.
Heavily.
Oh, I see. So when you had your change, that is what...
Oh, no. It had nothing to do with my gender change.
Wow, that's interesting. Well, that's a side issue. We won't go into that, but any more newish, but that was interesting.
Well, people will join cults for a lot of reasons. When I joined Scientology, it wasn't yet a religion. It was a cult. It was a way to get away from the world that would rather see me dead.
I see.
Okay, well, great. Thank you, Kate. Look very much forward to the piece, and congratulations on the wonderful book.
Thank you, Joey.
Bye-bye.
Thanks Joey. Yeah, great. All right. And
your performance work was quite amazing. I saw a piece called Hidden Agenda. PS-122.
Hidden Agenda, what's that about?
Hidden Agenda.
Hidden Agenda.
Hidden Agenda.
Hidden Agenda.
Yeah.
That's a great title.
You're very good with titles, aren't you?
I think it was...
It's like a snack or something.
Peggy Shaw said, if you give a show a great title, you don't have to worry about the rest of the show. People will come to it.
That's what we tried with Let Them Talk.
There you go.
We were talking earlier about some of the things you did before your change. You were involved in some interesting things. You want to tell us a little bit about that?
Well, I was first mate on an ocean-going yacht. I was a phone sex operator. I've been an actor, scene designer, ice cream man.
Okay.
I liked ice cream man.
That was interesting. You worked as a telephone sex operator?
Yeah.
What was that job like?
Well, that was great. Those was in the early days of phone sex. And these were in the days of, it was a party line. It wasn't one-on-one. And we used to have to just monitor the line and make sure guys were having a good time talking. Exactly. Exactly. So I think there's a, again, here we go. If you need to do sex work in order to stay alive, do it. Is it illegal? Yeah. Is that stupid that it's illegal? Yes. It should be decriminalized.
Why don't you give us a couple of concrete tips for people? Just pick out a couple of things that you would suggest in your 101 alternatives.
Okay. One of my favorite ones, when you're looking at the notion, if life ever gets to a point of it's not worth living, or it seems like it's not really worth living, and oh my God, what do I do? The answer is not, I found, to kill yourself, but to kill off a part of you that is making life unbearable. And again, this gets back to that postmodern stuff I was telling you about. As people, we live different identities. We create different identities for ourselves. You're not the same person you are with your lover, as you are with your parents, as you are with your boss. And sometimes we create an identity for ourselves that gets us into trouble. So if life isn't worth living, you kill off the part of you that needs to die. Don't kill your body, don't kill yourself. Just kill that part of you that created you didn't do a good job. And get that one gone, and then you wake up the next day and have a lovely life. And that is an alternative called go on a serial suicide spree.
Want to try another call?
Sure.
And oh, we just had him a second ago. Well,
they got no patience.
No patience. No, we're there. Patience. We're there, somebody. You're on.
Hello?
Hey.
Go ahead.
Hey, I'm the guy who tried calling about the fake pussy.
Oh, yeah. What was your question about the fake pussy?
Does it smell like Limburger cheese?
Well, only if you put some in there.
That wasn't even that interesting.
No, that wasn't good. Get a little more creative.
Yeah, a little more creative. Yeah, hi, you're on.
Hey, what's going on? Hey, I got a quick question, but if you just hold on for 1 second, I'm in a bit of a pickle. I got my nutsack caught in the mouth trap here. Do you hold on 1 second?
You're on. You have a question.
I've never seen.
Hello?
This is new.
They don't know what to say. I think you have them speechless, Kate. They don't even have anything clever to say that we were trying to play
you
off
know,
on.
You know, they need balls. I mean, when I had balls, they were bigger than those
10
guys.
Minutes. Right? We have 10 minutes more of the show. Think carefully of something really funny to say. All right, that's what we want you to do, please. All right, Kate, so 9/11 had that. Were you here in New York when 9/11? Where were you?
I was up in East Harlem at the time. And, you know, we could just open the back door and see the column of smoke. And I think, like everybody else, we just stayed glued to the television set and watching the sky. And I think what's the real terror that grew out of 9/11, I think, was how quickly such a terrifying government could grow up in the name of protecting us all. And, how quickly people were ready to stand behind the kind of government that would squash any kind of diversity amongst the population.
Out of fear.
Yeah.
And have you been involved politically? Have you been going to anti-war protests or doing anything along those lines? So making a contribution is your book, basically, is your contribution.
This is what I could do. In other words, If you keep building a culture, I think, on fear, then people who are trying to live just a good life for themselves, people who are outside the norm, have good reason to be fearful. And I wanted to do something. This has been my activism.
What's your website?
Thank you for asking. It's hellocruelworld.net. It's www.hellocruelworld.net.
One
you
word.
Can subscribe to a podcast there.
Oh, well. You have a podcast?
I do.
What's on the podcast?
Well, right now, the very first podcast is up, and it's an interview with Betty Dotson.
Oh, she's wonderful.
Yes, goddess of masturbation.
That's
that,
right.
That man who called with his ball sack in a mouse trap
probably
could use some of Betty's work.
Yeah,
and the poor man who likes to smell Limburger cheese.
no, no.
I don't know if there's anything that helped him.
Boy, there is a fetish.
He's beyond help.
Have trouble finding partners.
I would think so, you know.
Sorry. We give it another try.
All right. What?
Okay,
that's the number right there.
And
it doesn't take them long. Hi, you're on.
Hello?
Let them go.
Yeah, you all, the guest, I attempted suicide about 5 years ago, and so this really hits home for me.
And well, tell me a little bit about that, I mean, as much as you'd like to talk about it.
Well, I had really bad diarrhea. I was just at the shits for like 10 days.
I don't know if to give him a chance or to cut him off, but obviously... Yeah, that was a sad thing.
Something I wanted to ask you about on the website is that you have a section on the website encouraging people to donate books to libraries. And I think that's such an interesting mission because I adore the library. And I go to the library probably 3 times a week. I try to encourage all my friends to get a library card. And I think it can be the savior of somebody to just be browsing through and find a book like this and think, hey, I don't have to be so lonely. There's a way out. It's possible. So I just wondered what led you to think of a project like encouraging people to donate to libraries.
Well, when I was writing, it's a great question. When I was writing the book, I thought, well, where are people going to find it? And I didn't want it to have to be in a bookstore. I didn't want it to have to be, well, if I didn't have $15, I can't get it. Right, and I wanted it to be in school libraries, and so that was the initial thought. And then I thought, well, public libraries as well, because wherever I've lived, I've gotten a library card. And I just love the smell of libraries. Yeah.
It is.
Yeah.
And now, who designed the cover of your book, too, because it's such a hip look? And
isn't it great?
It really, I can see a young person picking it up.
Claire Skeets is a British designer, and she's over in England, and she designed it. I think it's got a kind of an Edward Gorey look.
It does.
Yeah.
It does. It's wonderful.
How did you come up with the title?
Hello, Cruel World?
Yes.
Well, that's actually interesting. Hello, Cruel World, that wasn't the exciting part. That was just like, rather than Goodbye, Cruel World.
Right.
The original title, subtitle was 101 Alternatives to Teen Suicide, because I was writing this initially simply for teens. And my publisher, Dan Simon, and my editor, Crystal Yakaki, suggested that, well, why don't you take a read of it, because it applies to more people than teens. And I agreed to open it up.
Was there any specific incident in your life or someone you know or something besides 9/11 that specifically launched on the idea of suicide or a specific reason why?
The son of a friend of mine, son of a friend of mine killed himself and
felt the tragic reverberations of that.
Yeah.
It's really devastating.
Was he a young,
in so
young,
many
young
ways.
Man?
21 years old.
Oh, wow.
So much ahead. Yeah, don't do it, people. It's worth it. Just hang on.
Did you do any research on suicide as a thing, you know, or aside from your own personal experience? Or?
No, I tried doing research on suicide, but every book, I mean, I tried to see, well, what's out there? Yeah. And this isn't suicide prevention. I'm not going to, I don't think I can prevent anyone from killing themselves, but... what I can do is give alternatives and books that
work. Well, it's kind of a soft place to fall too. For somebody who's feeling at loose ends.
What are some of the alternatives? Some of the various.
Well, take a deep breath and touch yourself. That's a good one, because your body. If you want to feel a miracle, your body's a miracle, and getting in touch with your body is important. Save the whales, the children, or the world. I don't like that one. I think if you save one whale, one child, or one part of the world, that's much more effective. Some of these aren't effective, but they will keep you alive for a day. There are some scary ones, like starve yourself, as I mentioned, Ben. I fight anorexia, but it has kept me alive for a very short time, you know, times.
Yeah.
I see.
I don't recommend that. It's got 4 little skulls.
Oh, I see. Yeah. Oh, I see. You register.
To,
I see. You code
how easy
them.
And how dangerous. Again, from 4 hearts, which is how self-loving, to 4 skulls, it's the most dangerous. Yeah. Umbrellas, 4 umbrellas is most effective. 1 umbrella is least effective.
Right, I see. Yeah. Code scripture for your own purposes.
Yeah.
That gets one heart, three skulls, and only one umbrella, and difficulty rating tricky.
But G. It's fun. It's fun. You know, like...
And it might work.
1 Corinthians has a great phrase. There is neither Jew nor Greek. There is neither bond nor free. There is neither male nor female. For you're all one in Christ Jesus. It says that in the Bible. You're not male or female. So I thought that's pretty good.
Here's an easy one. Take a Walk in the Woods, number 97.
Yeah.
It's got four hearts, four umbrellas. It's easy. It's got a G rating. And the key words are body, comfort, and spirit.
Well, so many times we get cut off from nature. We get this idea that nature's something out there that gives us food and stuff, but we are nature. And I think getting back in touch with nature gives us a good reason to go on living.
The other thing I think is so interesting in nature is that you can sit in the woods and you can look at a wildflower that'll be there for a matter of hours, and you can look at a gigantic tree that'll be there beyond your lifetime. Yeah. And you see the value in life, not in longevity. And it's such a message from the woods, from nature, to find that. So I think that's a great idea.
And
should we try one more call, or should we...
I'm always willing to give it a try. You're on.
Hello?
Hello.
Hi.
Hi, go ahead.
I just wanted to...
speak up a little
comment.
Bit, I'm sorry.
Hello?
Yeah, go ahead.
Hi, the young lady in the middle, the comment that she made regarding the suicide comment?
Yes.
Yeah, I just want to say that was an excellent point that she made, that removing yourself from life is not the way, just removing that aspect about you, that way of thinking. And that was just like really inspirational, and that comment was really appreciated. And thank you very much.
All right.
Thank you very much, caller.
Thanks a lot.
Okay.
It's been wonderful having you. I can't tell you how much we've enjoyed the show. And if you'd like to say anything, we have about a minute left before we wrap up to let people know about the book and your website again.
Your website, yes.
I would encourage people to go to www.hellocruelworld, one word, hellocruelworld.net. You can download a short 4-page version of the book for free. You get your own Get Out of Hell free card. There's some other fun stuff on the website. And again, the podcast is brandy new.
Oh, yeah. Right. Definitely check that out.
Okay, we're looking forward to that. And this has been Let Them Talk. I'm Paul DeRienzo.
And I'm Miss Joan Marie Moossy, and our guest has been Kate Bornstein with her latest book, which is brand new, called Hello, Cruel World, 101 Alternatives to Suicide for Teens, Freaks, and Other Outlaws.
And we'll have this show up on our website, pdr.blogomat.com, pdr.blogomat.com. And we'll